Today we have someone who we have heard before, but it's always a blessing to hear. So will you please welcome Karen Clark?
So I won't say that I come up with, you know, topics in the middle of Randy's sermons, but I might. And I think, yeah, because he'll be, wow, that's a new, you know, and then my brain, which is very swirly, bright, shiny object, kind of goes off and I've never thought about this or this. The problem is then I usually lose those notes or I need to cobble them together. So I have really no idea if this is actually that close to the original idea I had. But I started thinking about how important names are. We put a lot of emphasis on naming people, naming pets. Yeah, I learned at my house, it doesn't really matter what I want to name something because it's whatever Dave's going to call it. So, which was, you know, so I'd learned that through a couple of dogs and a cat. So it's probably really good that I knew that was true when we were in the process of adopting Isabella, because I'd always known that Dave wanted to name our child Elemeno, so that when she went to kindergarten, that she would, the teacher would say, what's your name? She'd go, Elemeno. And she'd say, how do you spell that? And she'd say, L-M-N-O, just like it sounds. I'm like, oh, good. You're setting our kid up first day in kindergarten to already be, you know, snarky. But, and I said, you can't really make that her name. But I knew enough to know that that was going to be her nickname. So I spent a lot of time backing up from that name. Well, Elemeno. Ella. Oh, so then I backed up into Isabella, because I like longer names too. It's like, that'll totally work. People will think the name came before the nickname. Not so much, not in our house at least. And so much the better, Isabella means consecrated to God. And because we waited so long for her, that was very much how we felt about this child. And I love the fact that we have a real statistically significant group of Isabellas at this church. I mean, we've got times three, times four. You could just, and here's another Isabella over here in Isabella. Hey, you know, as far as what names you might repeat, it's a very good one. Just saying. And I think names have power, like, you know, he who shall not be named. Like, we think they have so much power that we won't say them. And that was true, you know, back in, let's think, ancient times. So here's this new god on the scene. And, well, gods at that point were kind of limited. They were like a slice of the pie. Nobody really thought there was one that was the whole deal. You know, this god was in charge of fertility. This god's in charge of war. This god's in charge of healing. That made sense. So whatever your need was, that's who you're going to. So they had kind of names that were associated with that. And so here comes our God, and he's trying to, you know, Moses is trying to figure out, okay, so, but who are you? What do I call you? And it's as if he just has this name tag on it that says, hi, my name is, period. He says, I am. Oh, that's not even grammatically correct. Come on. You are what? There's, you know, I am. Am is a helping verb. It has to, you keep going. How can you just be I am? So I started really pondering, why did he change? Why did he choose such a strange name other than the grammatical issue, which does sometimes drive me up a wall? So first I realized, because unlike these other gods who were the goddess of fertility or war or this or that, he really is the god of everything. So I am means in totality, I am all of these things. Or I think in terms of the fruit of the spirit, like we mentioned this morning, I am joy, I am peace, I am love. Bonus point here that wasn't even in the sermon until Randy preached this morning. Bonus point. Notice his name is I am, not I do. And I think that's really important. He is peace. He is joy. He is love. I don't do these things. He exists as that or in that characteristic. So I am, not I do. There's a free one. I am as in I am everything. So and think about both the Old and the New Testaments. He shows himself to be all of these things, a pillar of fire by night, a pillar of smoke by day. He parts the Red Sea. He gives them bread. He does really crazy stuff to get them out of Egypt. You'd think when he came down to picking a name, he could have picked any of those really super cool moves, the parter of the Red Sea, or, you know, the bringer of water. But he comes back to, I am, just this existence. Although I think the whole, he could have gone with manna, which we'll get to a little bit later. That one almost works for me. He's not just the God of this or the God of that. He's the God of this and that and this and that and this other thing. Kind of like how God is described by John in the Gospel of John as light. Now that we've been able to take light apart, we realize that light is, what you're seeing here as a light, is all the colors, and then it's a whole lot of weird stuff you don't even see. Light is not just this shiny thing. It's frequencies, and it's the whole spectrum. He's all of it, all at the same moment. I find it interesting that as we learn more about our world, the things that are said in our Bible become more true or deeper, more influential. When they were talking about God being light in the New Testament, I think it was light versus darkness. But I love this idea that when we chose light, light is this multi-spectrum, really amazing creation. So he's everything, which is why he just kind of stopped from filling in the blank. I am. Because one of the things I think that we can take away for ourselves is that perhaps the totality of God is a bit much to handle on a daily basis. You know, God tells us that our brains at this point can only conceive somewhat of his amazingness. So I think he lets us fill in the blank sometimes. Because sometimes I need the God who is the God of comfort. I need God who is wise. I need God who is patient. I need to be reminded that in a dark place, God still is joy. He is that thing for me. Just like in the olden times when you went, you know, if you needed to talk about fertility, you went to the goddess of fertility. Hey, if you need to talk about joy, let's go to the God of joy. If you need to talk about your fears, or you need to talk about heavy decisions you're making, he is that God as well. One-stop shop. So right now, I want you to think, this last week, which of those characteristics, what is a characteristic that you needed God to fulfill? For you, what was he this week? Was he the God of, he is patient, he is kind, he's loving. Think about, what was he? Fill in the blank for yourself. And if you want, share it with the person next to you. I can only bless them to see who God is in other people's lives. is amazing. So, we have the free point, I am, not I do. This point, I am everything. Which I think also kind of that relates to being the only one. Once you're everything, you don't need a bunch of gods because you've got this one God that does all of this. So I don't claim to fully understand why God calls himself a jealous God, except to say, I think he wants you to come to him for everything. Therefore, he doesn't want you distracted worshiping a God that can't meet your need, that can't take care of what you need, because he can. So I think maybe jealous in that way. So he's the only. He's everything. He's the only one you need because he's everything. And then the one that I think I come back to most of all, I think he wanted us to focus on the tense of the verb. No, I'm not like parsing the Greek, but I am. Not I was, although he was. Not I will be, although he will be. When asked to describe the most fundamental characteristic of himself, he chose to say, in this present moment, I fully dwell right now, right here. Right here, right now. We're either here or we're not here. Kind of like a light switch. I'm present or I'm not present. Because if I'm a little bit not present, I'm really not present. Electronic devices, you know. We really can't multitask, they've told us. It's okay, I pretend all the time. This idea, though, of being fully present right here in this moment, this is super antithetical to, I don't know, our entire culture. I mean, I brought a visual aid because I certainly, even if I think and think and think about the beauty of this and the value of this, it does not mean I grasp it in my world. This is the calendar that hangs on the wall next to the door. Because so far, having three different calendars on a phone just doesn't speak to me quite well enough. So this is literally the next 2 weeks in our life. We might have, and this is mostly only my kid. I don't know, if I had more than one kid, I'd be dead. You know, and it just causes you to maybe, you know, your heart starts pounding. You're like, how are we possibly going to get through all of this? And I think that's where God's like, hold on. Let me show you. I am. Oops, wrong way. I am. You just have to be in today. I mean, yeah, there's things we might need to put on today to get ready for tomorrow. I get that as much as anybody does. But really, we could always hope he's going to come and then, you know, we're done. That'd be fun. He says, there are times when this is, you know, I can try to do this foreshortening of my view. But there are a few times in my life where it has been done for me. The first one I can think of is when we moved to China. And the first few weeks in China, we literally lived day by day because we had no idea what was happening tomorrow. We couldn't speak the language. We didn't know where we were going. We didn't know when school was starting. We didn't know what we were teaching. We didn't know where to shop. We didn't know how to shop. We were still learning how to count. Every day was like when you got to the end, hey, did we eat? Excellent. And we know where our house is. We found our way home. Fantastic. There's so much joy in achieving the things of just that day. Because I literally could not see beyond it. And for that whole first year, you'd try sometimes to anticipate, but no. There's just not a lot of ways to anticipate when you're in such a hugely different, completely disconnected situation. I think the same happens when you experience serious illness or loss. You really don't get much further than, okay, so today I have energy for today. I have tasks for today. I'm alive for today. Or when coping with loss, more than one time in my life, I've said, okay, just for today, I choose to surrender that object that I want. Just for today, I will choose to live without that thing that I want. I was thinking, too, as Mari and I were talking this week, about the exhaustion of new parents. And I think, actually, it may be God's way. It's another one of those times where he calls you back to, no, I am. All you really need is feed, rest. Okay, did we make it through a day? Yay, we made it through a day. You know, there's like vague things I really can't remember a lot from when. Now, and granted, ours was a little wonkier because we went from 0 to 6 months. You don't know what sore arms feel like until you have, I mean, I guess if you had a really big baby and you birthed said child. But then still no, because mine did not sleep that much. My child has never slept that much. So you have to entertain them and they're, and yeah. So I think even that is a gift. It's not a negative when your view, your perspective, you're in such a new situation, you're in such a strange situation, you're in such a dire situation. So what you come back to is, in this moment, I am. But in addition to being in this moment, he is still everything in this moment. And he's still the only thing you need in this moment. Which is where I hearken back to, I think, one of the names that God could have chosen that would have been very accurate. And one of the names that he is used to describe him in the New Testament is daily bread. Again, just enough sustenance for today. I mean, man, they went out and collected manna. If you got extra, guess what? It was no good the next day. I sometimes wish he'd do that for me. Okay, it does push me into understanding this. Be obvious, would you? Just enough for today. And more than enough. It's exactly enough for you and you and you and you and you. And it's perfectly what you need. So I want you to think for a moment. Not only is he everything you need, but he is all of those things right now in this moment. I don't really know how to integrate that with how we're supposed to plan for the future and personal growth, except to say that when I am truly focusing in this point, it's not like I'm really just repeating the same day over and over. I'm still growing. I'm still changing, maturing. So somehow, whatever it is that I needed to have to mature me or move me into a better position, to heal me, perhaps these are so incremental and so tiny that I just can't possibly see them in a day. Oh, Alicia Free sent me a picture of Brinley because I sent her a picture of Bennett because we were having a little too much fun in church. And she said, and I looked at it and I was like, oh my gosh, she looks different. In 1 week, how is it that she is substantially a different creature? But all she did was sleep and eat and poop and sleep and eat, cry a little bit, poop. And yet look how much she's changed. So we don't need to be scared about not accomplishing where we're supposed to be going with things. We're just, she's not planning ahead. We do what we're meant to do without trying to have to be the one who is in charge of all of that and figure it all out, because that's what God is. So I want to take a minute. I want to give you a minute first to thank God for being what he has been for you this week, and then I'll close, okay? So let's go to God. My God, you are here right now, in this moment. Not only here with us, but the amazing thing is, you are here with all of your believers. You're here for all of these people, and you love them so much. I thank you for the reminder, God, that you are everything. I thank you for the reminder that you are the only thing, and that you've chosen to define yourself as I am. God, help us to dwell in the moment with you. In Jesus' name, amen.